So first, when I talk about rocky exoplanets or Earth-like exoplanets, I want to define a little bit what I mean with that. So for me, an Earth-like planet doesn't necessarily really have to look like Earth at the surface. It could be, for example, a planet covered completely by water and maybe some volcanic islands are there at the top. But it would still be made mostly up of rocks and iron, or it could be a tidally locked planet, for example, or it could look like a scaled-up Mars super-Earth planet with some small lakes on it, or a jungle planet with life on it, or a plate tectonics planet where there are mostly continents and almost no oceans in between, which would also be quite an interesting case to look at. Or having like planets around M dwarfs where also the light would be different, the life that would evolve would maybe look more in a reddish color, or really Mars-like stagnant-lit planets, or really looking at planets like Earth where we have continents and water around. So these pictures, this is what I do if I have a lazy Saturday morning, don't know what to do, I try to paint a little bit. And well, I would call them exoplanets, but I actually liked it that it's more exotic planets that we're talking about. But actually, this is just my imagination, and the reality looks a little bit different. So what we do have are some data points, like what you can see here, for example, are plots for all the planets that have been discovered so far from a couple of days ago, where we know the mass and the radius. Up here, it's in Jupiter masses, so here's Jupiter. And in Earth masses, here you can see the Earth for reference, and the number of planets. And you can see that we have a lot of planets in the low mass regimes that have been discovered in the past years. And especially here, this is the super Earth regime, so going up to 10 Earth masses. We have quite a lot of planets that we have found that are on Earth size, a little bit larger, a little bit smaller. And that's all very nice. But what gets me really excited are plots like this, where we can see the habitable zone and we can fill more and more the space of the habitable zone with planets, also going a little bit closer to the sun where planets might potentially maybe be habitable. Well, because if you find life, or if there's water, there might be life, and this is what we're looking for. But actually the problem that we are coming to right now is that we find more and more planets here that might be potentially habitable, that might have liquid water at the surface, maybe not. And we might have to worry about which planets to actually look up, where we want to send our follow-up missions to. And so we need to look for all these planets that might potentially be in the habitable zone. Can we find some golden targets there? Is there some additional information that we can use to say, okay, these planets might be more interesting than the other planets to look at? So what would the planets most likely, or what would be the best candidates to look for? Well, if you first compare Earth to Jupiter or gas giants in general, or maybe let's use a different scale so it's easier to actually look at the planet. Oh, it's not working. Okay, well, we all know how Jupiter looks like. With gas giants, the problem is that maybe at the surface you might find a place where the pressure and temperature condition might still allow for life to survive, but you also have circulations. So I think we don't have to talk about it that Jupiter might not be the most habitable planet, and gas giant in general. So how would it be if instead we would look at icy worlds, so for example the icy moons around the gas giants, or water-rich planets covered by an ice layer? Well, these planets might or might not be habitable, so they might be interesting, especially in the solar system, to look for life. But how would we actually detect life on an icy world outside of the solar system? So since the ice sheet might actually shield the biosignatures from the surface, this might also not be the best place to look for life outside of the solar system. So then we turn to rocky planets, and I mean, we are all familiar with our sister planet Venus, and Venus is not the most habitable planet, at least today. It might have been different in the past, but these are speculations that I leave for the Venus specialists, like Mike Way, for example. But from the case Venus, we see that the distance to the star really matters, and even if you're close to the inner boundary, things can just go wrong. And also the time might be an important factor. So if you turn to another planet, Mars, and here I take Mars as a reference for stagnant lid planets, so planets that did not have, do not have plate tectonics, did not form continents at the surface. What about the habitability of Mars? Well, today we know that it's too cold and Mars was not able to keep its atmosphere. But the question would then be, would it be different if Mars would have been a little bit larger? So if Mars would have been the same size as Earth or even larger, would it be a habitable planet even without plate tectonics, for example? So this brings us then to the question of this new category of planets, the super-Earths. They might be rocky, they might contain some large amount of water. For me, a super-Earth just means up to 10 Earth masses. And that's the only definition that I mean with super-Earth planets. So this is something that we should investigate to try to find our golden targets that we want to look at in the future. So one thing that does matter if you want to look at the possible habitability and the evolution of these rocky planets, or mostly rocky planets, is the composition and the interior structure of these planets. And we just heard that from the stellar spectrum, we can find a correlation with planet composition for some elements, not for the volatile elements. Still, there has been a study right now from Santos et al. Where he looked at the stellar spectrum and he was inferring the possible composition in terms of iron content and water content. And if we have this information, what we can do with that? We can play around with the information that we do not have about the amount of water that a planet would have that would form around a specific star. But we can look at the variations that we have from silicate to iron and to metals. And what you can see here is an example of different interior structure models. So this is the radius. Up here is one Earth radius. All of the examples here, planets with one Earth mass. And you can see here change in water content. And depending on how much water we would actually have, we would need to compensate it with an increasing or decreasing iron core, because iron is denser than silicate, and silicates are denser than water. So we can try it with, if you have some information about the composition of the star and therefore about the building blocks of the planets, we can find some information about possible interior structures. But of course, it's getting more complicated. For example, right here in the picture, what I've shown is a pure iron core, a pure silicate mantle, so all the water and ice is here at the surface. Of course, in reality, some of the water would be in the mantle. We would have light elements in the core. We would even have iron in the mantle. So the question is then, if we actually have a mixture, so we have water and iron, for example, in the silicate mantle, does this change something? Does it matter, or can we ignore it? Well, no, we can't. Some examples I will give now where iron and water play an important role for the evolution of terrestrial planets or rocky planets. What you can see here is the melting temperature. So here are two plots where you can see how the melting temperature, so the temperature that the rock needs to exceed to initiate melting, it increases with pressure. But you can see here different colorful lines, and this shows the influence of iron. The more iron there is in the mantle, the lower is the melting temperature, and the same is for water. The more water I have in the mantle, the smaller or the more reduced the melting temperature is. Of course, melting temperature influences outgassing and evolution of the atmosphere, so it has severe consequences depending on the composition. Another thing that is influenced by the composition is the convective speed. So a more hydrated mantle or a more iron-rich mantle convects much faster than a dry and pure silicate mantle. So also the convective speed is very important if you want to look at the evolution of a terrestrial planet. So in all, we can say that, and also the outgassing products are also influenced by the composition and by the redox state, for example. So if you want to know more about the surface, about the habitability, and the surface, I also include the atmosphere here, we need to look at the interior. And one thing that is important, why we actually have to look at the evolution of outgassing, of volcanic activity, is if you look at the habitable zone. So here you can just see the habitable zone calculated at different times. So green would be a present day. Not as colorful as the other pictures that we typically see because this I painted myself. We always assume that at the outer boundary of the habitable zone, there would be enough greenhouse gases available for the surface temperature to rise above 0 degrees Celsius. But if you would actually have less volcanic outgassing, what would happen is that we cannot actually have habitable conditions at the outer boundary of the classical habitable zone. So the actual habitable zone would shrink depending on the atmosphere. And of course, it would be more severe if we have less volcanic activity. So what we can say is that something like about 10 bar CO2 and other greenhouse gases would be needed to be outgassed from the interior as long as no primordial atmosphere would survive. And what are now geophysical influences for the volcanic activity? Well, one thing that's very important is the delivery of volatiles to the interior of planets. So here you can see a picture of the magma ocean, and the magma ocean crystallizes and forms a residual mantle. And we have a catastrophic degassing into the atmosphere. But the question is, can actually some volatiles be contained in the mantle? And a new study shows that actually quite a substantial amount of volatiles, in this case H2O and CO2, can be kept in the mantle, which is quite important because then later on, over the evolution of the planet, we would have later outgassing of the volatiles, which would then lead to the buildup of a dense atmosphere. And it also fits to a study from Taka and Mukhopadhyay from 2014, who looked at isotope ratios of helium and neon. And they also suggested that about 80% of Earth's volatile were delivered to Earth prior to the moon-forming impact. So then we can look at outgassing over time. How do we do that? Well, we model mantle convection. So here we have a silicate mantle, which is heated up at the core mantle boundary. And we would have plumes going towards the surface. Or if you consider plate tectonics, we would have subduction of cold and hydrated plates into the mantle. In both cases, we would obtain melting, here due to the subduction of water, here due to the heat, which then leads to volcanic activity and therefore to outgassing and building up of an atmosphere. So how this looks like in one of the simulations, for example, you can see here in the yellowish color regions of rock that have been molten. And where the melt actually was rising to the surface and contributing to the buildup of the atmosphere. And yellow means that it's depleted in volatiles. And this occurs very close to the surface. So in this case, it's just the stagnant planets without plate tectonics. So it happens just underneath the lithosphere. And then the depleted material is convected into the mantle. And new primordial material can rise to the surface or to the lithosphere and lead to more outgassing over time. And this is also important if you look at the habitable zone. So this is a study that was just published this year by Tozzi et al. And they were also looking at the outgassing over time and how it would actually change the inner and outer boundary of the habitable zone over time, assuming that no primordial atmosphere would survive. So if you now look at the amount of CO2 that can be outgassed over several billions of years, we can take Earth, the planet Earth, and change it. So in this case, I looked at Earth and I zoomed it up, I made it bigger, I made it smaller. I changed the core mass fraction, so the size of the iron core. And I was looking at if everything else is kept constant, how does the outgassing of CO2 change? Well, what you can see is first that if you take a one Earth mass planet and you increase the amount of iron, so the size of the iron core, you have less and less outgassing. On the one hand, because you have smaller and smaller mantles and therefore less volatiles available, but also there's an important pressure effect in the lithosphere. So this, I should say, is only for stagnant planets. And a second effect occurs when I go to larger masses. And this is, again, a similar effect due to the pressure that is increased due to the higher masses in the lithosphere. I would expect less and less outgassing for higher and higher masses for stagnant planets. And I can also look at the general evolution of the outgassing over time. And what one can see is that first, if I increase the size or the mass of the planets from here from 1 to 2 Earth masses, I would expect more and more outgassing. Then if I go to slightly higher masses, up to like 3 Earth masses, the outgassing is shifted to later times, and also it's less efficient. And if I go to even more massive planets, again, it's only for stagnant-lit planets, I would not expect any sufficient outgassing at all. And to test this with Caroline Dorn and Antoine Rosel, we've run together 2,340 models where we really looked at all different parameters that could have an influence, looking at wet mantles, at different convection speeds, at different amount of radiative heat sources, and so on. And we always get the same shapes, that there's some intermediate mass range that is most optimal for outgassing of greenhouse gases. And for more massive planets, if you don't have plate tectonics, you would not expect outgassing at all anymore. And of course, this changes if you do have plate tectonics, because if at a plate tectonics planet, we do have ridges, and it ridges means that material, hot material, can rise directly to the surface, and therefore we would expect volcanic activity directly at the ridges. And also we subduct hydrated water into the mantle, hydrated crust into the mantle, water would be released and would lead to additional arc volcanism. So if we model then for different planet cases, so these are three cases where the planet has the same size as Earth, but we have different iron core sizes. And for the stagnant-lit cases, as I've shown before, we would expect less and less outgassing. But for plate tectonics planets, there's always sufficient outgassing that you can expect. And also, what's very important, it would be a long-term outgassing that you can expect. So plate tectonics would be a contributing factor for the habitability or potential habitability of rocky planets. Of course, then you can ask the question, well, how likely is it to have plate tectonics depending, for example, on the mass? So if you look at super-Earth planets, would we expect that they would have plate tectonics or not? And one could argue that if you look at Mars and then Earth, well, Mars is smaller than Earth, so increasing mass might lead to an increasing likelihood of plate tectonics. And so if I would continue to super-Earth mass, it should have plate tectonics too. And this is exactly what has been proposed in a study by Valencia et al. In 2007. In the same year, there was another study by O'Neill et al. Saying, no, no, it's the other way around. A couple of years later, Kovenaga said, no, no, the mass doesn't matter, it's the water. And since then, there are more and more studies going sometimes up, sometimes down, sometimes up, sometimes down. And in my PhD, I couldn't resist to also have a closer look. Actually, it really depends on other factors as well. So depending on what other initial conditions I set for my planets, then with the mass as a positive or negative factor for the initiation of plate tectonics. So this said, it means that for the super-Earth planets, we cannot say if we would expect plate tectonics or not. It's a huge question mark. Something else that is also a severe consequence for super-Earth planets, it's a study by Vlada Stamenkovic. If you look at magnetic fields are generated in the liquid core of rocky planets. And for the dynamo to act, what you normally need is a strong heat flux from the core into the mantle. However, if you go to these super-Earth planets, if they're stagnant-lit planets especially, they contain a lot of heat in the interior and the mantle. So actually, the heat flux is not that strong, might even be suppressed, might even go down to zero. In some of our simulations, we actually got a heating of the core by the mantle. This actually means then that magnetic field might not be too likely on these super-Earth planets. So this is another severe consequence for these massive rocky planets. So if you want to talk now about these most likely candidates or the golden targets, if you find more and more exoplanets, which would be the best ones to choose from? I try to make a scheme. It's a mass radius diagram. Where the black lines are from the pure iron shell to a pure silicate shell, so water is not taken into account here. And you have a region, which is the green region here, where the conditions for the classical habitable zone are most likely satisfied. Whereas if you go to the red region, it doesn't mean that planets there are not habitable. They can be habitable. It's just a statistical thing that the green region is more promising. So with this, I go to the conclusions, and you can see one of the simulations of the depletion of the mantle. And as said before, plate tectonics is definitely a good factor for habitability. Otherwise, we should maybe focus more on small massive planets. Also, water-rich mantles are a contributing factor for outgassing. The same is also for iron in the mantle. But in general, a smaller iron content leads to more volcanic activity. And of course, if a primordial atmosphere remains, it might also be interesting for habitability. And if I have 10 more seconds, I just want to show, announce a conference that will take place next year in Berlin in Germany, which is the European Astrobiology Network Association meeting. And of course, you're all invited to come. Thank you.